Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to Rosa Community Church. Pray that God has blessed you with a wonderful week. I just have a few announcements I will talk about. All the other ones you can look at in your bulletin and read along and take it home with you so you can remember them. First off, in two more weeks, we will start Terrific Tuesday. As you sign your name to the attendance pad today, if you would like to go to Terrific Tuesday, just put TT beside your name. What is Terrific Tuesday? We first offer a meal from 5:30 to 6:15, and then from 6:15 to 7:45, we offer discipleship programs for adults, youth, children, and we even have a nursery. If you would like to eat with us, the cost is $5. Now, where on earth, on Anna Maria Island, are you going to eat for $5? Or $15 a family, whichever is cheapest. You got a family of four, it's $15. You can't beat that. The first night, we're going to serve rotisserie-style chicken, vegetable, and Caesar salad. And for dessert, we'll have blueberry crisp with vanilla ice cream. So you better start writing it down. Don't want to run out. We don't want to run out. Also, for kids, we'll have white meat chicken nuggets, macaroni and cheese, and we're working on some other things. So kids' menu will always be available. A healthy option will always be available as well. So don't forget that. We would love for you to sign up. Just put TT beside your name today for that. And all the classes that we're offering are in the bulletin as well. If you would like to volunteer to help set up for Terrific Tuesdays, you only have to be here an hour beforehand. Just have to be here at 5:30. The sign-up sheets are in the back at the welcome desk, and we would love for you to volunteer. We only need five a week to volunteer. That's all we need. So if you can be one of those, we would really appreciate it. Also, next week, I will not be here. We are leaving early. Myself and six other people are leaving to for Baton Rouge, Louisiana, to go serve for 5 days and work on flood relief. Most of what we will be doing is cleaning debris and also deconstructing homes that have water damage. So not demolition, but just getting the old stuff out so we can put the new stuff in. There are people here today that are going. The people that are here, I'd like to call them to come forward at this time as we do a blessing and I introduce them as well. So if you guys can come forward.
I'd like to ask the deacons also to come and go. So we're going to lay hands on these persons. So if you're a deacon or a former deacon, we invite you to come.
Let me introduce the people that are going to Louisiana with myself. That would be Laura Clements and Steve Walter, who I don't believe is here today. And we also have Suzanne and Mike Pescatelli, Mike Meehan, and David Cheshire. What'd I say? Mike. This is Matt Meehan. Mike's his dad. Yeah.
All right. The scripture clearly says that when we're called to be followers of Christ, we're called to service of love and justice in the world. And these persons are going to be going to right outside of Baton Rouge to help with the flood relief. And we're not sure whether they're going to be doing debris removal or whether they might be actually hanging sheetrock at this point, or maybe a little bit of both. We're not sure, but it's going to be a difficult hard-working week for all of them. So we wanted to pray for them and bless them. So if you deacons would get to where you can touch, at least each one of you touch one of these persons, and then we'll offer a prayer. All right, make sure, there we go. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful and grateful to you for your call upon our lives to be in service. We're thankful for these people who are willing to give a week of their life to be in service to you and to your community of faith. We ask that you would bless them and use them as ambassadors from Roser Church and also ambassadors of Christ our Lord to share your love and your grace with the persons that they will come into contact with during this week at Baton Rouge. We ask that you would give them safe travel and that you would truly use them as ambassadors of your love in all that they do. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much. Also, I have a special person I'd like to welcome this morning. My much younger sister, stand up, Mariona. She didn't want to, she's embarrassed. She is 12 minutes younger than I am and has never let me forget it. Is that right? Yeah. So nice to welcome you and happy birthday.
Yeah. Just did the visitors.
So we are glad to welcome a lot of visitors. We also have an Emmaus reunion group who comes to Roser every year this week, and we're thrilled to have them with us as well. So, are there other visitors who are kind of first-timers today or people who are back from the frozen north? It's almost frozen, I hear. Anybody back? Any first-timers with us? Yes. It's nice to have you from Louisiana today. Anybody else? Indiana. Oh, that's even better. Great. Nice to have the Gilmores back, you know, that we had almost forgotten what the Gilmores looked like, and it's been so long. What a blessing to have them back. And Mary's back. What a blessing. You're not Mary. What about Jean? So Jean is back as well. What a blessing to have her home. So we also have a brand new child among us, and not here today, but was born this week. And Oliver, is that his name? Oliver. So doesn't she look like a glowing grandmother? Yes. What a blessing. And we're excited that Oliver was born safe and sound and doing very well. And that's really wonderful. Let's all stand and greet one another in Christian love. I'm good. How are you? Good morning. Hey, Gabe. How are you today? Good morning. It's good to see you.
Morning. How you doing? Hey, how you doing?
Good.
How you doing, man? How you been? Good, buddy. Good morning again. I do want to make cheerful today. I do want to make an announcement about. A lot of people have said, "Hey, that I just." There's no way I can go on a trip, either physically or my schedule doesn't work out. What can I do? I said, if you would like to give to the trip, there is a fund that we are collecting money to give to an organization. Our goal is to give $2,000 right now out of funds funds given by the congregation. We're only 1,900 short. So we're looking to, so if you just want to write Rosa Community Church and in the memo, write LA Flood Relief, okay? LA Flood Relief, it will go to the right fund and we can give it out of that fund. So, we would appreciate your donations. We're so glad that you are with us today.
Let's stand for our choral call to worship. Let's remain standing for a hymn of praise, hymn number 5, Come Thou Almighty King. Petition. Help us, O Lord, to trust you with all our hearts. Forgive us when we are too proud to confess our need, and when we rely too much on our own strength. Help us instead to rely on your love and mercy. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. We go to the Lord in prayer this morning. If you have a need, there are prayer request cards located in the front of your pew. You can fill them out, and as the ushers come forward to collect them, you can give them to them. You may have something that you just want to pray in secret about. Would you, as we spend this time in prayer together? We have continued prayers of strength and guidance and healing for Joyce and Shirley, their fight against cancer. For the healing comfort for the family of a 35-year-old nephew who died of a massive heart attack while running a marathon. For Jane, who has had 10 mini strokes and only 61, pray that they will find out what caused these. For Sonia to find employment. A nephew's marriage, that it may be strengthened. Prayers for a new grandchild, that it will be born next month. For John's new job and Kyle's new job and Stephanie's future. To give thanks for healthy grandson and daughter. For Joanne Russell, praise God, last year I have a place to live, a healthier attitude, new work, and lots of friends. Prayers for Jessica. She was rushed back to the hospital Thursday night. Continued prayers for, it is someone in his struggle with cancer. Wes in his struggle with cancer. For Matt, who just passed away. For his soul in heaven. For our daughter, Alex, struggling with self-destructive behavior. For Dr. Bob and BJ and Edie and Jimmy and Neil and Margaret. Bud and Sean and all in need of, and all in need in, or pain and peace. For Traveling Mercies home from Maine. BJ and Beryl. For our friends Kim and Vicky, who both lost their husbands suddenly this week. For Ann and her rapid recovery. And for all those affected by the bombs in New York City and New Jersey yesterday, that they might have peace. Prayers, peace for our country and peace for our world. Lord, in your steadfast love and mercy, hear our prayers, O God. Let us pray together. Gracious, loving Father in heaven, what a joy it is to be here in your presence. We know, Lord, that outside these four walls, Lord, pose a threat to us. Lord, even in your word, you said, in this world we'll have trouble. We see it all around us. We see the bombs last night in New York City and New Jersey, people who want to do harm. We see the people who are struggling physically. We see loved ones pass away or are in the hospital. But Lord, you said to take heart, you have overcome the world. Lord, help us to realize that through every situation, you are there with us, guiding us and leading us. You will never leave us nor forsake us. So we come to this holiest of houses tonight, today, and say thanks. Thank you for a refuge from the storm. Thank you, Lord, that we can gather together with other believers to pray together, to hear the word together. May it be upon Dr. Bob as he gives it today. Be with those in need, Lord, either spoken or unspoken. And for all that you do, we give you thanks. We ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
If I could have the children come forward, it is time for children. First off, someone very important has a birthday tomorrow, okay? So everybody go over there and tell Dr. Bob happy birthday, all right? It's his birthday tomorrow. Say happy birthday, Dr. Bob. Dr. Bob will be 41 tomorrow. He'll be a year older than me. I look a lot better, don't I? All right. If you just saw like a penny on the ground like that, what would you do? Yeah, Gabriel.
I would pick it up and keep it.
You would pick it up and keep it. Okay. What? I'll tell you what. Let's say you don't have a penny. You got a dollar over there. You would still keep it? Does anyone have a $20 bill? Okay. What if it was a $20 bill? What if it was a $100? Yeah, Gabriel.
Keep it.
What if it was a $100? I'm not leaving any change around you. What if it was a $100 bill?
I would keep it.
You would keep it?
Yeah, and give it back
to the... No. Yeah. Well, is it your money? It's not really your money anyway, but I can get into another topic of that. It's not our money, right? Isn't the right thing to do to give it back? Well, what if it was found in the church? Should we return it to the church? Would it matter if it's just a penny? Yeah, it does. Well, what's the greater sin? Is the greater sin to pick up the penny and keep it, or to pick up the dollar and keep it?
Dollar.
What do you think? The dollar? What's the answer? There's a saying. Sin is a sin is a sin is a sin. Doesn't matter if you pick up one that's one penny, or you pick up the other that's 100 pennies. It was dishonest, right? And you kept it for yourself. See, Jesus said whoever's can be trusted with little, if you can be trusted with this, he said you can be trusted with what?
Dollar.
It says much. You can be trusted with much. And if you're dishonest with little, if you're going to keep this, what do you think you're going to do when there's a $100 bill on the ground? Yeah, you're going to keep it. Yeah. He said, whoever's dishonest with little is dishonest with much. Yes, Gabriel.
I never find dollars,
only pennies. Yeah, that stinks. I know. I know.
No one ever picks them up.
Emily.
It's not
wait, wait. You got to have you raise your hand.
If there's money on the ground and you pick it up and you keep it, isn't it
scary? That's right. That's right. You just need to pick it up and take it to whoever owns. Now, if we can get into what if it's in the road, what if it's it? Yeah, okay. I'm just saying, if you know the right thing to do, you should do it, right? You know what the right thing to do is. You can do that. You can send out a letter, say if you own it, we'll see. You know.
If you
can't find the person who wants to keep it. Yeah, but hey, have you seen $20? Oh, me. Anyway. Well, it's not just to do with about money. It has to do with everything you do. And the thing is to teach about honesty. Is you have to be honest. Because if you're honest with a little Jesus, you know, God's going to say, man, I can trust Gabriel. Gabriel's my kind of guy. So he's going to give you a lot to trust. But if Emily, you don't do, if you're very dishonest with little, God's going to say, man, I'm not going to give her a whole lot. I don't know about that. I'm just saying. I'm not saying for real, okay?
So remember, honesty is very important to God, and God will give you more the more honest you are. All right? Now let's pray together, and then you can go to Sunday school with, is Mark got it? Mark got it. Mr. Mark's up. All right? Let's pray together. God, help us to realize that the least little things matter to you, and we need to be honest in all aspects of our lives. I thank you for these children and the families they represent. Father, I pray they have a great time as they learn more about you. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Now it's time for the giving of God's tithes and our offerings.
Thoughts and mild, Lord,
sisters in Christ, let's affirm our faith together by saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's remain standing for our hymn of preparation, 320. Come, let us praise the Lord. You may be seated. Scripture lesson today comes from Matthew chapter 21, verses 33 through 46. Jesus says, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. When the harvest time approached, he sent his servants to the tenants to collect his fruit. The tenants seized his servants. They beat one, killed another, and stoned a third. Then he sent other servants to them more than the first time, and the tenants treated them the same way. Last of all, he sent his son to them. 'They will respect my son,' he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, 'This is the heir. Come, let's kill him and take his inheritance.' So they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" "He will bring those wretches to a wretched end," they replied. "And he will rent the vineyard to other tenants. Who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time?" Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures? 'The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in your eyes.' Therefore, I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruit. Anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parables, they knew he was talking about them. They looked for a way to arrest him. They were afraid of the crowd because the people held that he was a prophet. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
When I was serving a church in Raleigh, we made the decision to build a new sanctuary, and part of the project was the renovation of the old sanctuary, and the part of that renovation included adding a new entranceway or narthex into the new sanctuary that would tie all the buildings together. And so it was really two projects in one. The building of the new sanctuary was one project, and the renovation of the old building was the other project. And they both kind of went together. And the church voted kind of overwhelmingly to do this project. And as the new building was going up, there was a group of folks who got together and decided that we were spending too much money and we didn't need to do the renovation of the old building. And so they got together, as groups do in the church, they got together and came together kind of en masse to a council meeting, and they put a motion before the council that we not do the renovation part of the project, and it passed. And I was kind of discouraged, as you can imagine, because the two projects went together. But as the new building was being completed, the members of the church were kind of scratching their heads going, you know, this doesn't make sense. We don't have a way into this new building. There's no new narthex. There's no new entranceway. And the two buildings are not tied together, and it doesn't make sense. And so the original project came back before the council a second time, and the second time they voted again, this time, to do the whole project. The interesting thing was that because we had put it off for 8 months, the cost had gone up $100,000. It was phenomenal. Sometimes groups get together in the church and they rebel. I know that's never happened at Rosa and never will. Rosa, of course, is the perfect church. But in other churches, these kind of things happen. People rebel sometimes. And when they rebel, it almost inevitably leads to greater problems than they would have had if they hadn't rebelled. Jesus tells a story about a great rebellion, a very foolish rebellion. A rebellion in which some servants, some tenants, try to take over the master's vineyard. This incredibly powerful story has some important lessons for us. The first is that this life, whether we like to admit it or not, has some limitations. We can't get everything we want. We sometimes don't even get everything we deserve. We just are not going to have every single thing that we think we ought to have. God is incredibly generous, but the Bible begins with a story about God telling us that in spite of his generosity, there are some limitations. In the story of Adam and Eve, Adam and Eve are given this incredibly beautiful garden, Eden, in which they can just enjoy life to its fullest and completeness, but God has one limitation. Don't eat from the fruit of the tree of life. Don't eat from that tree. Anything else you want, you can do. But people being people, people didn't like having limitations. We are much the same as Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve, of course, took the fruit and ate from it, and we are all bearing the consequence of that. That first sin made us all sinners, and we have to bear with that. The book of Genesis tells another story about how God says, I'll let you go just so far, but only so far. There are limitations. That's the story of the Tower of Babel. The people got together and decided that they were going to become equal with God, and to get to be equal with God, they were going to build a tower that reached all the way to heaven. God let them go so far, but only so far. We need to acknowledge that there are limitations in this life. And that though God is incredibly generous, the scripture says he is more generous than we can even conceive or even begin to comprehend. In spite of how generous he is, God lets us know that there are limitations. Another way of saying this is that God is incredibly patient, but God is incredibly patient, but at some point, even God reaches his limit. The second thing we can learn from this powerful parable about the vineyard is that we cannot successfully rebel against God. Now, we need to acknowledge that all sin is rebellion. Paul, in writing about this later, said, while we were in open rebellion, in the very midst of our sinning, Christ died for the ungodly. The scripture makes it clear that every sin is a rebellion against God. And we rebel against him every time we make the decision that we know better than God knows how to run and rule our lives. One of the things that we find troubling about Jesus is that Jesus condemns the very people that we admire the most. He starts off by condemning rich people. And as you know, we like rich people. All of the people we listen to on the television and the radio are rich people. You know, they must be somebody that we should listen to because they've made it. We admire and we respect self-made men and self-made women. I have to admit to you that I have never watched the Kardashians. I don't know even who the Kardashians are. If someone was to show me a picture of the Kardashians, I wouldn't know them. But apparently it's one of the most popular television programs in the United States, people watching these rich people and trying to live lives like the Kardashians. We admire rich people, and Jesus condemns them. Now, Jesus doesn't condemn being rich. In fact, Jesus wants us to be incredibly successful. But Jesus acknowledges that rich people are much more likely to be people who will turn away from God. Jesus said it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter into heaven. And another group of people that we admire tremendously but Jesus condemns are the powerful. The people who are in power and who rule are people that we, for the most part, admire. Now, in our society, we are blessed that we can also complain about those who are in power, and we don't get in trouble for that, and that's a good thing. It's part of the wonder of America, this thing we call free speech. And yet we discover just how much we admire people who are in power when we continually re-elect our own congressperson. America historically thinks that Congress is doing a horrible job, and yet we always, almost always, re-elect our own. It's all the other congressmen out there that aren't doing a good job. Our guy or our gal is a good guy or a good gal because we admire the powerful. But Jesus condemns those who are in power, especially those who are in power who do not use their power for the benefit of the good. And this is astonishing to me, but it's certainly clear throughout the scripture, that Jesus condemns the pastors, the Pharisees, the priests. Oh, I'm just stunned by that, aren't you? I know that he would never, if he came today, he wouldn't condemn those folks, would he? Those people who are supposed to be the shepherd of the sheep and yet are leading the sheep astray. This passage of scripture which we read together today says to us that the scribes and the Pharisees and the chief priests were very, very upset about what Jesus said because they knew he was talking about them. But in our society, we admire priests and pastors, don't we? One of the most difficult things for us to understand is that Jesus makes it clear that when we put our trust in the wrong people, we are rebelling against God. And we can't do that successfully. It's also a foolish rebellion when we ignore God. Most of us really know what it is that God wants us to do. But we ignore what God calls us to do. We would rather do things our own way and have things in our own way of thinking than to be obedient to God's call and to God's will. We see this throughout our land. In the last 60 years, 50 years, there's been such a dramatic shift in morals. It's just unbelievable what we as a society now accept as being okay, that 50 years ago was completely and totally condemned by all of society, not just the church. It's such a dramatic change. And part of that has come from the fact that we as a people, both the church people and the nation as a whole, have accepted a whole new set of standards, a whole new set of morals, a whole new way of looking at life. This incredibly powerful passage of Scripture also teaches us that there is no privilege without obligation. The stewards that the vineyard owner hired to look after his vineyard were given a great privilege, but that privilege also carried with it the responsibility of being faithful to the owner. God has called us to be stewards of this incredible world, and we in America are the most blessed of all the blessed in the world. We are the richest of all the people in the world. Even our most poor people would be considered unbelievably wealthy in comparison to the rest of the world. We are so blessed, and that blessing carries with it responsibility. Many of you are old enough to remember what the world was like at the end of World War II. Many of you are old enough to remember the terrible devastation that was a part of our world. Almost all of Europe was destroyed. China was destroyed. Most of Japan was destroyed. And you remember that the American people, through the Marshall Plan, stepped up to rebuild a destroyed world. We spent billions and billions and billions and billions of dollars in rebuilding Europe and in rebuilding China and rebuilding Japan. We spent money to restore the very people who had sought our destruction. And that money was well spent. Because we built a peace that has lasted for all these years since, great privilege carries with it great obligation. Most of us are guilty of wanting to enjoy the vineyard without actually paying for it. Occasionally in the afternoon, I'll go home a little early, and I just flip on the television. The television is just on. It's a way of me getting my mind off of the world. And occasionally I'll see like Judge Judy in the afternoon. And I'm always amazed when I'm watching Judge Judy at the people who are, it's amazing how many cases there are that deal with rent or with leasing an apartment. It's amazing how many people want to live in a place without paying for it. And Judge Judy always says, how do you think like that? How could you think that you could live in a place and not pay for it? Don't you know that the person who owns the building deserves the rent? It's always clear that the person who's trying to get out of paying the rent always loses. And God's going to say the same thing to us as well. We have an obligation. We have the obligation to respond to His incredible generosity. The final thing that this passage of Scripture teaches us is that the rejected are the ones that God picks as the chosen. One of the things that we need to remember is that God uses us as long as we're willing to be used. But when we stop being faithful, God will choose someone else to fulfill his task. Well, if you're not sure about that, all you have to do is read the Old Testament. The Jewish people were given the promised land. And they were promised, as long as you are faithful to me, I will be faithful to you. But if ever you should stop being faithful to me, you'll lose all that you have. In the book of Jeremiah, there is a scene in which the people are parading around, I guess, almost like a protest march, and they're carrying signs, and the signs in Hebrew read, Hallel Yahweh, and they are repeating over and over again, they're chanting Hallel Yahweh, which means the temple of God, the temple of God, and they're saying it over and over again, the temple of God, the temple of God, the temple of God, and Jeremiah interrupts this march. And he says, why are you saying over and over again, Hallel, Yahweh? Because if we remind God that the temple is his, then he will protect it. He said that he would always live there. Jeremiah looked at those people and said, don't you know what's already happened to the nation of Israel? Don't you know what's already happened to Shiloh? Shiloh was God's most holy place, even a holier place than the Temple Mount itself. And Shiloh had been turned into nothing but a pile of rubble. Jeremiah says to the people, because you have failed to be the people that God called you to be, even Jerusalem and even the temple will be destroyed. And Jeremiah, unfortunately, was right. When we fail to be faithful, God will find a people who are faithful. Every new denomination began with a group of people that the church had rejected. They were almost always poor people and uneducated people and people that the church had decided weren't good enough. All you have to do is look at the history of the Presbyterians, or the Methodists, or the Baptists, or the Puritans. They were all people that the church, the Catholic Church, the Episcopal Church, whatever church it may have been, the church had rejected. When the people of God stop being faithful to God, God will raise up a new people who will be faithful. Finally, let us remember this, that only God can save us. If we have been guilty of a foolish rebellion, it's only God who can save us. If we have been guilty of killing off his servants, only God can save us. If we have been guilty of being bad stewards of all that God has given us, only God can save us. If we have been guilty of ignoring God and going our own way, only God can save us. If we have been guilty of being sinners, only God can save us. We must not fall into the trap of thinking that we can save ourselves. Only God can save us. Brothers and sisters, let's let God do what God can do. Amen. As we sing our final hymn today, I would give you the opportunity to ask God to move anew into your life, to help you to recognize your own rebellion and to be forgiven of that rebellion. Let's stand and join in the singing of the hymn, Jesus, Lover of My Soul, number 461. Sermon's ever boring and you need a good one, just turn to those words, that hymn we just sang, and just read that. That'll be a good one. That'll be in some other church, of course. Right. Let's receive this blessing. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord graciously with his favor look upon you and fill you with his love and grace throughout this day and all the days to come. Amen.